Well, good morning, West Dodge. It is great to be with you. Hopefully you had a blessed Thanksgiving and you got to eat a lot of food and spend time with family and friends, and hopefully you enjoyed football. If you're from Iowa, you enjoyed football. If you're Nebraska, you maybe didn't. But anyway, it is great to be with you this morning. For those I haven't had a chance to meet, my name is Brian Demmel. I am the campus pastor of Lifegate West Dodge, and you might be going, what is a campus pastor? Well, Pastor Les Beecham is our senior pastor, and at every campus, there's a campus pastor. So today at Midtown, Pastor Micah will be preaching. At Papillion, Pastor Mike Hens will be preaching. George will be preaching in Lifegate Belgrade, and Pastor Kiki in Novi Sad, and I'll be with you this morning. So we just like to welcome all those different campuses and those watching online. Can we give them a greeting as we like to do every Sunday? Truly is great to be with you. Last week, we took a look at our vision statement, and we kind of unpacked that and talked about how to practically live that out. And I think it's going to be on the screen. We're going to do kind of a second installment of our Think Local series, and we're going to really talk about this vision statement. What does that look in my life? What does that look like in my locale and where I live? And our vision here at Lifegate is simple. It says we have an endless passion. That means it never stops. To invite people everywhere, that's where we live in our locale, to discover, live, and give life in Jesus. So last week, if you were here, we talked about what is life in Jesus and how do I discover that? And we talked about different discoveries that have impacted us as a people over the course of centuries. And some of the discoveries that we talked about were microwaves, DNA, we talked about fingerprints, X-rays, electricity, that was a big one. That changed a lot when we discovered electricity. Penicillin, radio waves, oxygen, the germ theory, gravity. All those discoveries are significant. And the thing with discoveries, many of them already existed, but people just didn't know it. Isn't that interesting? And as many of these discoveries, some of them are life comforting. They just make our life more comfortable. Some are life changing. They literally change the way where we live our lives. And literally some are life saving. And so we asked the questions, what is life in Jesus? How do we discover this? We also heard the true story of a young man who discovered what life in Jesus is like. And it truly was a discovery because this young man didn't know it existed. He grew up with religion. He had a knowledge of God. He had a respect for God because of his upbringing, but he had no relationship with God. And that story was very impactful. It changed my life forever because it was my story. I share my testimony here with you about how I met Jesus at age 26, and he changed my life forever. If you had asked me if I was a Christian before that, I would have said yes, but I did not know him. And also last week was our baptism weekend, and sometimes we don't take time to celebrate. Last week we had 35 people said, you know what, I'm taking my next step in my journey with Jesus. Yeah, yeah. By making a declaration that I'm all in, Jesus, and they went down in that watery grave representing salvation, come up a brand new creature. And also 20 of you gave your life to Jesus that same weekend. That is worth applauding, and that's why we're here and why we exist. It's awesome. So as we jump into this Think Local series again, I'm just going to define what is your locale? And the definition of a locale is a place or locality, especially with reference to events or circumstances connected with it. Really, your locale is where you live. It's where you work. It's where you play. It's where you recreate. And so last week we talked about how to discover life in Jesus. So I think a really fair question now is, now what do I do? You know, when I gave my life to Christ, it was this transformation. It was impactful. It was dynamic. But then it's like, now what do I do? What does God expect from me? So how do I live life in Jesus once I become his follower? And what does that look like in my locale, where I live and the people I interact with? So we're going to talk about that. So if you ask people the question, what does God expect from me? And we ask that even in this room or online, if you ask that question, we would get a lot of similar answers, but we would get a lot of different answers. And unfortunately, here's what can happen. You enter this new relationship, and then all of a sudden people say, well, you need to do this, and you need to do that. And you need to read this, and you definitely need to read that. You should act like this, and you shouldn't act like that. you should do this, you shouldn't do that. All of a sudden, this liberating, freeing relationship with Jesus, you start feeling restricted, and it gets boiled down to doing a bunch of stuff. So remember, religion is about rules and regulation, do's and don'ts. A relationship with Jesus is exactly that. It is a relationship. Now, there are disciplines and rhythms that will help you in your walk with Jesus. And I'm actually going to talk about that the last weekend of this year. I'm going to be speaking to all the campuses on how to create healthy rhythms that help me in my journey with Jesus. But today I'm going to share a simple message with you. You know the gospel literally means good news. And the things of God, they're dynamic, they're powerful, they're impactful, but yet they're simple. And I think too many times we complicate things, or we disqualify ourselves from walking with Jesus because we either don't think we're worthy or capable. What if I told you there was one verse in the Bible that told you, just one verse, that told you what God expected from you? Would you want to know what that is? Boy, I would. We're gonna unpack that here in a bit. But one thing I do want to share, when I gave my life to Christ, and it was dramatic, and I started growing, I just got hungry. I got in the Word, I went to Bible studies. I knew enough that I need my dirty little brainwash. I need all the help that God could get, so I just went after God hard. And then this process started happening in me as I was thinking. I thought, okay, I'm a Christian now. I'm a Jesus follower. I need to do the will of God. Because isn't that what Christians do? You need to do the will of God. But then as I started experiencing it more and this relationship developed, it moved me to a place where it's like, well, I really want to do the will of God. And now it's moved me to a place that I don't ever want to move away from. It's what I call a healthy desperation. It's, I have to do the will of God. I desperately want to do that. And we're going to look at this one verse. And I believe if we could live our life by this one verse, it would bring great pleasure to God and would be bring blessing to us and those we're around. If you were here a couple weeks ago, Pastor Les talked about his disorder. And I'm not talking about his hip, but he talked about having OCD, obsessive compulsive devotion. I don't know if you remember that if you were here a couple weeks ago. By the way, Pastor Les, I got to see him yesterday. He gives his regards. He's actually posted a video on his Facebook page. He wants to bless you, so I'd encourage you to check that out. But here's the reality. When you fall in love with Jesus, I find myself now doing some of the same things I used to do, but I'm doing them now out of devotion and not duty. Does that make sense? I do it because I want to, not because I have to. So we're going to look at a verse, and if you want to turn your Bibles or in your app to the book of Micah, we're going to look at one verse. Can you say one verse?
One verse.
We're going to look at one verse. Now, Micah was a prophet in the Old Testament, and there's several things in the book of Micah, but one of the main things Micah did, he prophesied that out of Bethlehem would come the Messiah, come the Savior. And it's interesting to note that Bethlehem literally means house of bread. And what really fascinates me, out of the house of bread came the bread of life, Jesus. So there's a lot in the book of Micah, but we're going to look at this one verse, and it's Micah chapter 6, verse 8. It's going to be on the screen. I'm going to read it out of the New King James Version, but we're going to unpack and look at it in a couple other verses as well. It says, "He has shown you, O man, what is good," and here it is, "and what does the Lord require of you?" Here it is. Three things. To do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly before your God. I like to read this also out of the Amplified Bible. It says, "He has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Except to be just and to love and to diligently practice kindness and compassion and to walk humbly with your God, setting aside any overblown sense of importance or self-righteousness." I like that. And the last piece I want to read is out of the Message Bible. And it says this, "But he's already made it plain how to live, what to do, what God is looking for in men and women. It's quite simple. Do what is fair and just to your neighbor. Be compassionate and loyal in your love. And don't take yourself too seriously. Take God seriously." You know, it's interesting, the rabbis in the Old Testament, they boiled down the precepts of God to 613 precepts in the law. Can you imagine trying to keep 613 rules? Eventually, they boil it down to 11. We find that in Psalm 15. And eventually, they boil it down to 6 commandments. You actually find in Isaiah 33, 15. But here, we see it boiled down into 3. Can you repeat after me? I can remember three things. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to take this verse, and we're going to talk about what does this practically look like in the world I live. So the first part of it is to do justly. What does that mean, to do justly? It really means live a life of integrity. Live a life of integrity and character. I looked up the definition of integrity. It means adherence to moral and ethical principles, soundness of moral character, and honesty. You know, you maybe heard the statement, your true character is defined, or you know what your true character is by what you're like when you're by yourself. How do you act? What do? What do you think about when you're by yourself? I looked at a few statements that people have made about integrity and character. The philosopher Plato makes this statement. He says, when men speak ill of you, so live that nobody will believe them. The author Mark Twain makes this statement, always do right. This will gratify most people and astonish the rest. I like that. And humorist and cowboy Will Rogers makes this statement, live your life in such a way that you would not be ashamed to sell your parrot to the town gossip. Isn't that good? Well, you know, even Jesus, what did Jesus say in the Golden Rule? He said, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. It's a simple thing of treat people the way you want to be treated. My wife and I, when we ran our family business and had our employees and we ran youth ministry, we would be so frustrated sometimes with people. Have you ever been frustrated with people? And don't you love people? And I love people. But we would go, why is it so hard just to do the right thing? But you know what? We as Christians sometimes don't do the right thing. So what's the essence? To me, the simplest definition of do justly is do the right thing. Can you say do the right thing? You know, for those of you who have children at home, it's been said this way, the best way to teach character to your children is to keep some around the house. You know, people are watching. We all know that things are better caught than taught. Let's look at Psalm 25, 21. It says, let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Integrity and character are very, very important to God. Now, I'm going to say, what does that look like for me? You know, I look back in my life. I look at my dad was a great example. My dad was a hardworking German Lutheran farmer. That was his background. And I'll say this about my dad. He was very imperfect, but I watched his life. The man always did the right thing. He just did the right thing. And that had a big impact on my life, because as a little boy, I thought, Lord, I just want to do the right thing. I was praying this week as I prepared this message, Lord, I just want to do the right thing for you, for this church, for this campus. And so I'm very thankful for that core value. But did you know your core values will always be tempted? One of the things, when I was at age 5, I'll never forget, we were living in rural Kearney. This is back early 60s, so if you lived down the country, it was a big deal going into town, and you'd save your money. And I remember I'd take my nickel. Do you remember when a nickel bought something? And we'd go to the store, and my deal, I don't know why, because it was just rotten, was that taffy that's about this long and this wide. It's just a big flat, I mean, just jerk your teeth out. I mean, it's horrible for you. But that was my deal, and I remember buying my piece of taffy, and we were on our way home. We lived about 5 miles out in the country, and I discovered that it was so thin, a second piece had got stuck to it accidentally. And I bawled, and I bawled, and I bawled, because I had something that didn't belong to me, because that core value was in me. Now, I must admit, later in life, when sin seared my conscience, I didn't have those convictions. But that core value was in me. This is another test. You know, and there again, doing the right thing is real important. I'll never forget, we were youth pastoring, and we had just been to Worlds of Fun. We'd taken our youth group to Worlds of Fun. And you know, when you go to the amusement parks, you get those tokens, you know, for different things. And, you know, a lot of those tokens, back then, they were about the size and the weight of a quarter. Do you know that? And so I was headed to work doing my normal thing. I stopped at a Casey's. I was going to buy a newspaper. That's actually, you bought newspapers and got them out of a machine and got my coffee. And I'll never forget, I dug in my pocket, and I was kind of in a hurry, and I had a quarter, and I found one of those tokens. So I dropped the quarter in, and I'm thinking, I wonder what's going to happen if I just throw that token in there. And it went click, pop, and I opened it up, and I took the paper out, and I got about 3 steps, and I'm going, what am I doing? I literally was ready to compromise my integrity for a quarter. So I went back in the store, had to break the dollar, got the four quarters, put one in the deal, put the other three in my pocket, and went on my way. But know this, doing the right thing isn't always easy. I'll never forget when one of my kids went off to college, it was either Corey, Ryan, or Rachel, I can't remember which one. And I remember, it might have been Corey, you know, you're trying to pass on some wisdom to your kids, and hopefully they've caught some things. And I remember telling Corey, I said, Corey, I want to tell you something, you will never ever regret doing the right thing. It isn't always easy, it's usually not very popular, and it's rarely convenient, but you'll never regret doing the right thing. I said, however, you will regret somewhere along the line when you don't do the right thing. I know, because I've done that. So integrity takes effort, and it's very, very important. You know, I remember a wise man said to me, it was shortly after I got saved, I was still struggling with different things. I was trying to figure things out, and I wasn't doing this Christian thing very well. And I remember this man, he sat down and said, Brian, and this is advice I've given many people, and I share this a lot of times with couples when I'm doing premarital. He looked at me and said, Brian, it's never too late to do the right thing. Isn't that good? Even if I haven't up to this point, even if I've just made a mess of things, I can say, you know what? From here on out, by the grace of God, I'm going to do the right thing. I found this article I want to share with you about doing right. It says, people are unreasonable, illogical, and self-centered. Love them anyway. If you do good, people will accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Do good anyway. If you are successful, you will win false friends and true enemies. Succeed anyway. Honesty and frankness will make you vulnerable. Be honest and frank anyway. The good you do today will be forgotten tomorrow. Do good anyway. The biggest people with the biggest ideas can be shot down by the smallest people with the smallest minds. Think big anyway. People favor underdogs but follow only top dogs. Fight for some underdogs anyway. What you spend years building may be destroyed overnight. Build anyway. Can you repeat after me? Do the right thing. Okay, we're gonna now shift gears a little bit and talk about what does that look like in your locale? What does that look like where we live? Here are some questions for us to consider. How do you drive and park your car? See, it always comes back to driving for me. It's a real deal I got. God's still trying to sanctify my driving. And my irritation with people who just, for some whatever reason, can't use a turn signal. It's like, it's just too much to ask. I mean, anyway, I'm working through this, you can tell. Drives me nuts. Here's one. How do you fill out your tax returns? Are you honest at work? How you fill out your expense reports? How you claim your hours? Do you help yourself to office supplies? What do you do when the clerk gives you too much money back at the store? Do you tell the truth? Do you keep secrets when asked to? These are just really good questions. This is just good for us to take inventory from time to time. You know, here's what I found. Have you noticed that there is very much a great lack of integrity and honesty in our world today? Has anybody noticed that besides me? There is a great lack of integrity and character and honesty. And here's what I found. A lot of people that don't have any of themselves, you know what? They want to follow someone who has some. Let's be that person. As followers of Christ, let's be that person. Okay? Can you repeat after me? Do the right thing. Okay, shifting gears. The second piece of this verse, love mercy. We're going to look at the great commandment, Matthew 22, verses 37 through 40. A lawyer asked Jesus, what's the biggest commandment? What's the great commandment? And Jesus said this, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now, here's what we got to understand. That word love there is the word agape. Can you say agape? Can you say it with a little flair? Agape. I just like saying that word. Agape is God's unconditional love. It is a supernatural love. There is nothing natural about it. Okay? Because we live in a world where we're so used to conditional love. I'll like you if you like me. I'll love you if you love me, but if you cross me, it's over. No, God's love is unconditional. There's nothing you can do to disqualify yourself from God's love. It is a supernatural love. Now, here is the reality. It's released by a choice on our part. If you're a follower of Jesus, and I don't know how God does this, but it's one of the most amazing miracles. It is the most amazing miracle. When you give your life to Christ, I think back where I was 34 years ago. That night I gave my life to Jesus. He put within me a brand new spirit that's now alive to him. I had a spirit that was dead in sin. I became born again. I love the dialogue that Jesus had with the Pharisee Nicodemus. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. You become a new creature. The other thing he does, he puts a deposit of that agape in us. How do I know that? Romans 5:5 says this, for the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who's been given to us. So at the point of your salvation, he puts a deposit of your love. Now, we used to joke because my mother was one of those people, her love seemed to be at skin surface. You just squeeze her and boom, it came out. And off the rest of it seemed like it was way down in there. But here's the reality. Every one of us have that love. Now, who am I going to pick on? Let's say Eddie. Let's say Eddie and I get in an argument. Yeah, Eddie. And we have a decision to make. I can either react in the flesh or in my natural way I normally react, or I can pause. Normally for me, I have to take a deep breath. Or I can say, no, I choose to love Eddie. And then the supernatural love flows. It's not natural. I like to say it this way. The love of God is like spiritual super glue. It holds relationships together. It's like a relational adhesive. The best way to define to love mercy, I believe, is to walk in love. This love that's been extended to us, as we receive it, then Jesus is asking us to extend it to somebody else. Look what Jesus said in John 13, 34, and 35. He says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. By this one thing will all people know that you're my disciples, if you love one towards another. I chuckle when this is the way my mind works. I can just see the Son and the Father going, they didn't do so good with 10. Let's give them one. Let's just give them one. Let's make it easy for them. But here's the reality. If you are walking in the love of God, you won't lie. You won't steal. You won't covet your neighbor's house, boat, or wife. Are you with me? We walk in that love. You know, we have to be very careful. And I've been guilty of this. It's so easy to condemn in others what we condone in ourselves. Boy, we need to cut people slack. How many of you have ever had a really bad day? Today might be that day. Do you appreciate when people cut you a little slack? You're having a rough day. You know, I think the essence of this is just let's cut people slack. Let's give them some grace. Let's extend the mercy to them that Jesus extends to us. See, many times in our life, we want to receive mercy, but then we give out justice. You know, there's a principle in the Bible called reaping and sowing. I can't continually sow judgment and justice and condemnation and expect to get mercy back. Boy, if you want mercy, start sowing mercy. Look at one other verse, Luke 6, verses 36 to 34. The words of Jesus, part of the Beatitudes. He says, therefore, and anytime you see the word therefore, go back and see what it's there for. It's connecting a thought. But there's some other really good stuff. Verses 32, we're going to start here. Therefore, be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. The reason Jesus wants us to love mercy is he poured mercy out on us. It goes on to say this. Judge not, and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will it be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. The way we would say this in our house with our kids, the way you dish it out is the way it's coming back. The way we give is the way we receive. So we got to make sure we're extending mercy. You know, if you read the Beatitudes, it's just crazy talk without the agape love of God. How can I love those who hate me? How can I love my enemies? In the natural, I can't do that. But you know what? When you receive this relationship with Jesus and he puts his love in you, we are able to do supernatural things. St. John Chrysostom makes a statement. He says, mercy imitates God and disappoints Satan. That's really good. I'm going to share something with you. You know, in the Apostle Paul, the book of Galatians, talks about the fruit of the Spirit. You know, the fruit of the Spirit, we know it's love, it's joy, it's peace, it's long-suffering, it's love, it's it's kindness. But I really appreciate what he writes about the fruit of the Spirit, about love in particular, this mercy we're talking about. He says, love is the key. Joy is love singing. Peace is love resting. Long-suffering is love enduring. Kindness is love's touch. Goodness is love's character. Faithfulness is love's habit. Gentleness is love's self-forgetfulness. Self-control is love holding the reins. So in my locale, in your relationships, let's ask these questions. Do you extend grace and mercy, or do you become irritated and hold a grudge? When you drive and someone cuts you off, has that ever happened to you and you have choice words for them? Now, let me ask this question. Have any of you ever accidentally just not seen somebody in your blind side and cut them off? Those of you who didn't raise your hands, you did and you just don't know it. And there have been times I thought, man, I'm sorry, just cut me some slack. But then do I do that when the guy does it to me? This is where we live. Do you hold a grudge? What about that neighbor or coworker who just drives you nuts? I have a neighbor that's been a real challenge for me, and I told my wife, I go, was it bad that when I saw the for sale sign go up in his yard, I got really excited? She goes, yeah, that was bad. That was bad. Actually, she might have thought the same thing. I'm not sure. So what does it mean? We just need to extend grace and mercy to others the way Jesus does to us. See, here's that when it comes to the love of God, this is really important. We are ambassadors. If you know Jesus, your Lord and Savior, you and I are ambassadors of God's love. You can say it this way. We're agents. We're actually his authorized dealers of the love of God. And the love of God is the most powerful and irresistible force on the face of the earth. It's what drew me to Christ. I was around these people who were loving. They were weird, I thought, but they had the love of God. The peace of God was all over them. Can you repeat after me? Love, mercy. Okay, and the last piece. Do justly, do the right thing. Love, mercy, it's walk in love. And the last is walk humbly with your God. The word humble means not proud or arrogant. Do you know what the opposite of pride is? Humility. I'm just going to share this. Pride has been an issue. I think for any human being, we all wrestle with it, but pride, ego, and vanity has been something I've wrestled with most of my life, just being very honest. And it all stems from insecurity. I mean, that's the basis of most of that. You know, pride is listed as one of the seven things that God hates in Proverbs chapter 6. It's the first one listed. Let's look at what God's word says. 1 Peter 5 says this, likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. That word submit is a very important word. We're going to come back to that. It says, yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility. In other words, we need to walk in humility. We need to walk humbly before God. How many of you have been around a very arrogant, proud, conceited person, and then you're around a humble, just good person? Which one would you rather be around? The humble person. It says, be clothed with humility. Here's a great phrase, for God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, go back to see what it's there for, because he gives his grace to the humble and resists the proud. Humble yourselves. See, I can't humble Bob. Only Bob can humble Bob. No one can humble me except me. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God so that he may exalt you in due time. God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. You know, that word resist, that when I first saw that, I think of resist as more of kind of a passive, kind of a defensive thing. Like if Bob was going to charge the stage and I said something he didn't like, and, you know, if he came at me, I'd be in big trouble. But I would resist him. I would resist. I kind of look as kind of like this. If you look at this word in the Greek, the word resist means to oppose, frustrate, and defeat. Do you know what that verse is saying? God opposes, frustrates, and defeats the proud. But here's the good news. He gives us grace to the humble. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't need God opposing, frustrating, and defeating me. I need him helping me. Amen? So as we learn to walk in this humility, you know, it's really interesting. Think about this. What letter of the alphabet's right smack dab in the middle of the word pride? I. What letter of the alphabet is smack dab in the middle of the word sin? All sin, all pride is when it becomes about me, when I become Lord, when I become the most important. See, pride and rebellion got Lucifer kicked out of heaven. We now call him Satan, and he's our adversary. We're going to look at another verse here, 1 John 2:16. You know, the book of Ecclesiastes says there's nothing new under the sun. There's nothing new under the sun. People have been people the same from the beginning of creation. And the same way Satan tempted Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden is the same way that he tempted Jesus in the wilderness, and it's the same way he tempts you and I today. And here's what it is. 1 John 2:16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh feels good. The lust of the eyes looks good. And the pride of life are not of the Father, but it is of the world. You know, occasionally God knows when we need to have things brought in perspective. And I ran across this story I thought was very interesting because it dealt with Omaha. I want to share it with you. Success can sometimes dazzle you in the achieving, but there's usually someone around to help keep perspective. TV newsman Tom Brokaw has a story about that. Remember Tom Brokaw? Brokaw was wandering through Bloomingdale's in New York one day, shortly after he was promoted to co-host on the Today Show. That show was a pinnacle of sorts for Brokaw after years of work, first in Omaha, then for NBC in Los Angeles and Washington, and he was feeling good about himself. He noticed that a man was watching him closely. The man kept staring at him, and finally, when the man approached him, Brokaw was sure he was about to reap the first fruits of being a New York television celebrity. The man pointed his finger and said, "Tom Brokaw, right?" "Right," said Brokaw. "You used to do the morning news on KMTV in Omaha, right?" "That's right," said Brokaw, getting ready and set for the accolades to follow. "I knew it the minute I spotted you," the fellow said. Then he paused and asked, "Whatever happened to you?" You know, occasionally the Lord knows when we need perspective brought. You know, Isaiah 1:19 makes this, it's a great verse. It says, if you be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. Obedience, submission is very much a part of humility. And, you know, submission is a very interesting word. Did you know there's a difference between obedience and submission? It might be on the screen. Obedience is an action. Submission is an attitude or a posture in my heart. Case in point, I can be obedient and have a stinking rotten attitude in the process. See, God not only wants obedience, and obedience does bless God. He loves him. You know why he likes us to obey him? Because it positions us for everything he has for us. He doesn't do it for him. He doesn't need our obedience. He wants us to obey so he can bless us. But obedience is an action. Submission is an attitude. To illustrate this, I forgot the story. There was a mom who was disciplining her little boy, and he was just being naughty. She said, "Johnny, you go sit in the corner. I'm going to spank you." And he just stood. So she came over, and she spanked him. And she goes, "Now you go sit in the corner." He wouldn't do it again. So she spanked him. She goes, "Johnny, go sit in the corner." I mean, this goes on two or three or four times, just wailing on the poor kid. Finally, after about the fourth time, he goes in the corner, and he sits in the chair. And with tears just running down his cheek, he looks in defiance at his mom and said, "I might be sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside." That's obedience. That's not submission. Now, we laugh at that, but you know what? We've done stuff like that. My story is this. You know, my family, I'm very thankful for my family heritage. I come from a long line of German hardworking perfectionists. And you know, it was interesting. My brother and I had this conversation. My mom's side, we would go to both my grandmas. I loved them both. But the atmosphere was different. When we go to my mom's mom, the Knapp family, it was laughing. It was joyful. I never heard my grandparents ever say one ill word about anybody. So we just always loved going to Grandma Knapp's. We go to Norfolk, we go to my grandma Demmel's, and she was a wonderful woman. But it was just different. Because on that Demmel side, we were always the best farmers, we were the best athletes, we were the best students. So I have that bent of pride in my family. Our joke in our family is when we have an injury, we go, oh, don't worry, we have Demmel bones. Like, what in the world is that supposed to mean? They heal fast, which is just so ridiculous. What is that? It's pride. Oh, it takes 6 weeks to recover, I'll be back in 2.5. Stupid. So here's some questions for us. In my locale, in my family, at work and play, would people say, boy, he or she is humble, or would they say something else? Here's one for those of you who have children in your home. How do you find yourself talking about authority? Government officials, teachers, coaches, bosses. Do you always feel the need to defend yourself? Do you find yourself putting yourself in a light that is not really accurate or true? So what does this mean? What does this mean, walking humbly before God? I believe it boils down to this. One of the ways we walk humbly before God is walking humbly before men. And we don't usually get to choose who that is. You know, I almost daily, on a regular basis, I pray Psalm 19:14 and Matthew 5:16. And I just pray this because it's my heart's desire. Psalm 19, it said, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Matthew 5, it said, Lord, let my light so shine that people will see my good works, but glorify you who's in heaven. You know, I truly believe that worship is a variety of things. How many of you love our worship here? I mean, is our worship off the charts or what? But I truly believe one of the highest forms of worship is how we live our lives. It's how we live it out there. How do we treat the clerk who just isn't getting it right? How do we treat the waitress that messes up your order 3 times? Are we walking in love? So, here's some questions to ask and steps to take. In your locale, where you live, work, and play, ask yourself these questions. This is just good inventory. No judgment. We do this imperfectly, but God wants us to live a pleasing life before Him. I really believe that. How am I living my life? Am I living a life of integrity? Do I do the right thing? Second question, do I show, live, and share the love of God? Do I extend mercy to others? Third question, am I walking humbly before God and man? So here's some action points. About the time you're tempted to judge or not extend mercy or not do the right thing, remind yourself of where you were, lost and empty, and what you were, a guilty sinner, before you found Jesus. See, that brings in perspective. Judgment isn't a problem for me because anytime I'm tempted to go there, I just remember where I was at before Jesus found me. It wasn't pretty. Next action point, stay close to Jesus. And we're going to talk more about that at the end of the year. How to develop healthy rhythms of spending time in His Word, spending time in prayer, being around the family of God, to position ourselves so we can truly live this life in Jesus in a healthy way. And this is a big one. Don't do it alone. Be in community. This life in Jesus, you can't do it by yourself, nor what you ever intended to. Get in a life group. If you're a guy, you want to know more about how to be a man of God, come on Wednesday nights where the West Dodge Huddle is going. Women, we have women on Tuesday morning and Tuesday night. January 11th, I'll be starting the next round of Reset. It's a seminar where we talk about how to read the Bible, how to pray, how to forgive, how to hear the voice of God. And that's open to non-believers, new believers, returners, or maybe you've been walking with Jesus for 20 years and you just want to go deeper. I want to encourage you to come to that. I teach that. But don't do it alone. Be in a community. And the last one, ask God for His grace to live a life worthy of imitation. You know, you've probably heard this phrase probably over the holidays. You'll hear it. You know, you're at the dinner table. Hey, help yourself. Whatever you need. We were at my daughter's. We ate for like 8 hours on Thursday. I went from the couch to the table about three times. That's all I did. Help yourself. Whatever you need. Do you know that living this life in Jesus, you know what really simply is? It's saying to Jesus, help yourself. Whatever you need. And just being willing to say yes to whatever that is. You know, as we learn to live this life in Jesus, do you know it brings peace? It brings contentment. It brings fulfillment, which leads to freedom. Freedom to live like our servant king, and freedom to impact those who are around us. We can do this. We can do the right thing. By the grace of God, we can learn to walk in love. By the grace of God, we can walk humbly before God and man. And when we do that, watch God's kingdom expand. Let's pray. Well, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the incredible mercy and grace that you extend to us. Father God, we thank you for the love that you exhibited by sending your son Jesus to die for our sins. Then, Father God, we thank you that you didn't leave us alone. You gave us your word. You gave us an instruction book on how to live this life in Jesus. And if that wasn't enough, you sent your Holy Spirit to empower us, to give us the grace to walk a life worthy to be imitated. Father God, we thank you that when we fall, you encourage us to get back up. That when we do it imperfectly, you're excited about the steps we take. And so, Father God, I just pray for every person here that as we continue our journey with your son, Jesus, Lord, use us to help others. When they look at our lives, Lord, let them see there's a difference about that person. Lord, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. We thank you that we get to be called yours. And it's all because of your son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We always appreciate hearing how God is moving in your life. If you've been impacted by Lifegate Church, we'd love to hear from you. Please email mystory@lifegateomaha.com. Thanks again for joining us.